So that is the first Sarabande and Bouree, the first tune from this concert and contest collection that we all know and love so much. And so what I'm going to do here is talk a little bit about both of these movements so that you might have something to work on as you practice this at home. First, we'll start with the andante. A couple of important factors that I'd like to point out about this. Obviously, we have to be sure that when we start this movement, we have a nice full tank of air in our lungs. So often I see young players who take a breath, but it's a really inefficient breath. What do I mean by that? They don't get as much air in their lungs as they could, and a lot of that has to do with how they breathe. So one of the things I see the most is people actually breathe with the horn in their mouth through the horn, like this. Okay. That is about as inefficient as you can imagine because there's all of this resistance to the air actually getting into your lungs. If you have to take a quick breath, good luck because you've got all this crap in the way and you can't actually breathe as efficiently. So what I recommend that you do is actually drop your jaw, drop your tongue, and take a breath with as big of a mouth as you can, like this. So. Now I know opening your mouth and putting your mouth back on the instrument and blowing immediately is kind of nerve-wracking because you never quite know if your lip is in the right place or if you're going to squeak. So there's an exercise that I'd like to tell you about, what I call the beginnings exercise. And what I'm going to suggest that you do is practice doing this on an F major scale and simply play each note, open your mouth between that note and the next, and then play the second note, like this. Like that. So I'm not breathing after every note or I would probably pass out. But the whole point is you want to be able to open your mouth and then close it and play a note as quickly as possible with the right embouchure. So you don't want to do this. That's what you want to avoid. Etc. That way you can actually just sort of practice doing that part of it without the breathing. Then eventually, when you start this note, in the beginning of this piece, for example, your mouth knows exactly where it's supposed to go. Okay, so the first thing. Second thing I want to talk about is so this whole beginning section before the repeats, which I didn't do any of the repeats in this, is written piano, except for a little bit of hairpins at the last couple measures. Now, piano is not a dynamic, which means that, or any dynamic, it doesn't mean that everything has to be the same volume. In fact, piano or any other dynamic is kind of a range, right? So piano, there is a range in piano, which is, you know, sort of piano minus to piano plus. It's all in there in piano. If you played everything the same volume, it would sound really, really boring. Meh, not so interesting. So if you shape this a little bit, and it's very important, so, just little bits of shaping. If you go to mezzo piano, you know what? Bach isn't going to come back and beat you up. He's kind of dead. So, you can make these little adjustments in this piece. Just makes it a lot more interesting. And play within the range of piano. Last thing I want to talk about in this movement is these held notes that hold over the bar line. When you take a breath in there, you have to be sure that you don't cheat that C, or in the next measure, that B, it carries over. If you don't carry it over, it kind of loses the point. Kind of ugly. Carry it. Okay, so make sure you carry them through, release the note in a nice way, don't just kind of stop the note. And then, you know, take a quick breath efficiently, like we talked about, and then continue on. So that's the first movement. The second movement, marked lively, is all about articulating. And I'm going to talk about this as quickly as I can because I don't want this video to go on too long. But each note, the one thing you want to be careful about is that each articulated note shape is not this kind of squared off ugly, and I'll show a graph of what I mean by that in a second, squared off ugly, non-shaped sound. All of those notes have no shape and they all have the same shape. So how do I get that sound? How do I think about it? Well, I'm going to draw you a graph right over here. And you'll notice the y-axis is volume and the x-axis is time. So in the kind of squared off ugly sound, you start the note at the volume, the same volume that you end the note, the same volume, you play the volume all the way through, and then when the note is over, you kind of stop it, like that. Those notes have no shape. Not especially interesting. Now, what I'm going to show you next is the way I articulate. And what I call, this is called, actually, in this graph, it's called an envelope. They use it a lot in sound synthesis. But what it is each note, each articulated note, and the whole thing has four parts to it. There's the attack, there's the decay, there's the sustain, and then there's a release of every note. Now, the attack is the first part of the envelope. And what that is the volume, the time it takes from when you get to zero volume, from when you start at zero volume to you get to the full volume of the note. Okay? Da. Then there is the decay part, which is actually very quickly to where you get to the sustain of the note. So, notice that the attack of the note is actually louder than the main part of the body of the note, which is called the sustain. And then the release is actually the time it takes to go from the sustain, the volume that you sort of are holding in the body of the note, to nothing again. That's a long release. It's a short release. But no release sounds like this. There's nothing. So that unshapes the note. So again, if you were to play this, if I were to play this envelope slowly, it would sound like this. Sorry. So that's a long attack, a relatively long decay, a medium sustain, and a long release. I'll do that again. Now I'll do it quickly. When you do it really quickly, basically there's no sustain. It's just an attack and a release. Or an attack, a decay, maybe a small sustain and a release. And so to make this kind of music interesting, you basically change the length of every envelope of every note. I know it sounds complicated, but ultimately that's what makes this interesting. Has a slightly different envelope to it, but none of them have the squared off non-shaped note. So that's really what's incredibly important about this movement. Obviously you want to have, you know, shape to all of the phrases, etc., but since so much of this movement is tongue, you know, you can follow the dynamics and that will get you part of the way there, but the shape of every articulation is what's going to get you the rest of the way. Okay? Hope this was helpful. Thanks.